So, in the last class, we saw different types of ways to solve this problem of finding the maximum of three numbers. We also looked at how to handle functions in shell programming. We also saw an example of a recursive function, and we will continue with the same subject. What we will do this time is we will try to introduce a new variation of the if statement, where in the else part also consists of another if clause. So, this is called as the else if clause. So, what we do is in this case of solving the problem of trying to find out the maximum of three numbers, we found out that we had a logical error in the problem, whereby in few of the cases we were not able to identify which was the maximum of the three numbers. How to now come up with logic for solving the problem? So, if you look at this, what we will do is that in the if statement, we had put statement like this: if num1 is greater than num2 and num2 is greater than num3, then this will imply that num1 is greater than num2 than num3, and therefore num1 was declared as the maximum of the three numbers. Now, we can proceed the logic in the same fashion and write like the statements that are given as given. So, in the first if condition, we can announce that if num1 is greater than num2 and num2 is greater than num3, then we can announce that num1 is the greatest of the numbers, and then we can exit the program. And then we can again write another if statement, where we say if num1 is less than num2 and num2 is greater than num3, then we can say that num2 is the greatest of the three numbers, and this can continue. Like this will be one if statement, this will be another if statement, and so on. So, this is exactly what we tried last time. What we will do now is we will try to introduce the if then, and then if you look at this, whatever is in red, the else if part of the statement. So, previously we solved the problem using if then else and phi, and we found out that we had a problem with this, but anyhow it was working for certain cases, and we also understood the importance of doing unit testing. And what we will do is we will now come up with a new version of the code using this statement. We will run some unit test on these and see whether the program is working fine. So, let us take the look at this program, which is called if elif. So, in this program, if you see, we are now taking the three numbers which are the parameters as $1, $2 and $3, and what we are doing is we are actually executing inside the if statement. Okay, if you look at this, now we are trying to find out if number 1 is greater than number 2, and if this number 1 is greater than number 2, then we compare number 2, whether number 2 is greater than number 3. So, if number 2 is greater than number 3, then we announce that number 1 is the maximum, which is according to the logic that we showed in the previous slide. Now, then we get out of this, and the most important part occurs here. Look at this: if number 2 is not greater than number 3, that means number 2 is less than number 3, then we again try to see if number 3 is greater than number 1. Okay, because what happens in this case is number 1 is definitely greater than number 2. But we see that number 3 is also greater than number 2. Therefore, we have to find whether number 3 and number 1, the relationship between number 3 and number 1. So, if number 3 is greater, then we announce the result to be number 3 is the maximum, else we announce number 1 is the maximum. And if you look at this part, okay, so if you look at this, this if then else if else phi. Now, this becomes one complete if then else statement. Okay. So, if you look at this, this is a part of, so inside the else part we are having another if then else. Okay, and if, so now this else part, okay, after this the else part consists of an if statement, and this if statement consists of two else parts. Okay, and then here what happens is now we are taking the second condition: if the number 2 is greater than number 3. So, if number 2 is greater than number 3, then we say that number 2 is already, number 2 is the maximum, and so on. So, let us see whether this program, this logic whatever you have found, will give the right answer. So, we will run this program and then we will see whether this gives the right answer. So, what we do is we save this program and then we will run this, Since we, let us change the executable permission for this, and then we can run this program. So, if we do not give any parameters, now the program, actually there is a bug in this program where we are not doing the usage check. So, if you had listened to the lectures earlier, we told you that whenever you write such programs, you should have the usage itself. Now that we have written the program, we know the usage, so there is no problem here, but in any case you should always write how to use the program. So, in this case let us try to give the, we have to give an input of 3 numbers. So, we will give 10, 20 and 30, and this exactly prints that 30 is the maximum. Now, let us try to find out, okay, what happens if we reverse the order. Okay. So, we will give 30, 20 and 10. So, this program again prints 30 is the maximum. Let us give some other number so let us say let us give 15, 45 and then 30, and it still prints 45 is the maximum. So, the first 3 test cases where we give the first number as the third number as the maximum, the first number as the maximum and the second number as the maximum, this program passes. Now, what we will try to do is, in the previous program if you had the if statement that we saw that when we gave 2 numbers as equal, it was not trying to detect the maximum of the numbers. Therefore, what we do is, we will try to give 10, 10 and then 45. So, else if dot sh 10, 10 and 45. Okay, now it clearly detects that 45 is the maximum number. Now, we will give this position, this 45 in between these 2, okay, and then see, okay, then also it works correctly. Now, we will position this 45 as the first one, and then we give 10 and 10, and even in this case it detects the maximum number. Now, if you remember, this was one of the cases where we had an error in the previous program. Now that it has detected the maximum number, so what we will try to do is, we will try to give other test cases where we try to give say all the numbers as equal. Okay. So, if you give all the numbers as equal, say 30, 30 and 30, and it says 30 is the maximum, which is okay. Now, the question is this program working correctly? Okay, we will leave this as an exercise to you to show, to prove or disprove whether this program is correct. So, what we will do is, we will now again see the program once, probably you can take a look at this or note down the logic, and you can prove using say a decision tree or some other technique, decision table or whatever technique, to find out whether this program works correctly or not. We saw that it passed the 6 test cases, but that does not mean that there may not be any errors in the program. So, if you really want to prove that the program works correctly, probably you might have to go for some kind of formal proof mechanism, but at least in your case you can try to make use of decision tables. Please refer to the web on what is a decision table or a decision tree and see whether this program can works correctly. Now, moving on. So, what we do is, we see that, okay, the if statement, until now we have been only doing the comparison operators with numbers. Now, what we will try to do is, we will try to see whether we can do a file check operations. So, one of the things with shell scripting is that it is not necessary that the conditions, that is inside the if statement, must be only numeric. As long as the condition is boolean, okay, the if statement will work. So, and in most of the cases in shell scripting, you may not be playing with numbers, but you will be playing with either files or strings. Okay, of course, in the forthcoming classes, we will see how to handle strings within the if statement or within that conditional part of the if statement. Currently, what we will try to do is, we will try to understand about file test operators which can be used inside the if statement. Okay, the idea behind the file test operators is that, since shell scripting is going to handle more of your operating system files and directories, they have provided special facilities to test the whether there is your file, whatever file you are giving is existing or not, and whether your file is a special file, and provided, and whether the file has got a read permission or a write permission or a execute permission and so on, and you can also find out what type of file it is. So, if you look at the way you are supposed to identify what type of file it is, We will now look at an example and then come back to this slide again and see how the example and this slide matches. So, what we will do is, we will try to take this file called file test.sh. Let us see how to do this operation. Okay. So, let us take this statement. Okay. So, this program actually expects a file name to be given to it. Okay. So, since this expects a file name to be given to it, what we do is, the file name will come as the parameter $1. Now, what we are trying to do in this program is, we have put minus f. See, if you look at this statement, it is if space, then we are opening the square bracket, then we are giving a blank, we are giving a minus f, okay, and then space, and then we are putting $1. $1, you know, is the first parameter, that is nothing but the file name that you will be supplying, and there is a space, and then you are closing the brace. So, if I use this condition, say minus f $1 or minus f file name, this condition in shell scripts tries to identify whether this file exists and is a regular file. Regular file is any text file or whatever it is, okay. And there are regular files and special files, hope you would have heard about that in your previous lectures. So, this is whether it is a regular file. So, if this statement becomes true, that means if minus f $1 becomes true, then this program prints $1 file exists and is a regular file, otherwise it prints the file does not exist. Now, let us go back to this slide and see this. So, what we have used is this part of the code. So, minus f file. So, it says true if the file exists and is a regular file. So, similarly, what we can do is, in order to check whether the file has got read permission, whether it has got write permission, or whether it has got executable permissions and so on, what we can do is, we can perform checks like this. So, if you look at line number 16, we see that we are checking using an option called minus x. So, let us go and see what this minus x option is about. So, if you look at this minus x option, which is the last one that is shown here, it tells you that it is true if the file exists and it is an executable. So, first what we do is, we just invoke the bash shell, and then what we try to do is, if the program, you supply one parameter, okay, then the argument, a parameter or the argument, then it will work correctly. If you do not supply the parameter, then what happens is that it just goes down. Okay. Of course, this program has a error, you need to find out what error it is, okay, in the usage part of it. Okay. And then finally, if everything is fine, if you provide one argument or one file, then it tries to identify minus x option, minus r option and so on. So, minus r option is to find out whether the file is readable or not. So, let us see how this program works, and we will try to show with an example. So, let us take one file. So, probably let us say file test dot the current file itself. So, we will test the current file itself, and if you look at this current file, it is a regular file because it is a shell file. So, if you look at the options at the bottom, I mean, it tells you that it has read, write and executable permissions for the current user. So, what we will try to do is, we will try to execute this file, okay, file test.sh, and then we will do the file, the same file name. So, what we are testing, our own file using this program. So, it tells you that it is a regular file and it is an executable, it is a readable file and it is a regular file as well as it is an executable file. Now, so let us now go ahead and try to see what happens if I give a program which is not an executable file. So, there is a file called newfiles.sh. So, we will run the same program on newfiles.sh. So, let us see what happens when we run the same program. So, if you look at this, it says that even though it is a shell program and even though it is readable, now what has happened is that since the file is not executable, and this can be seen by looking at the fact that the newfiles.sh, the x part of it, for both the user group and others, it seems to be dash. Okay. So, in this way, if you want to identify, now this identify what happens with this file file permissions, you can use the minus f file name, or you can use any of these options that we had discussed. So, you have options like minus b, whether it says it's a block file, I mean, it's, then you have a character file. I mean, this block file and character file are used for in case of device drivers. Then you want to find out whether it's a directory, you can use the minus D option. Then you can have options like minus G, minus H and so on. And all these things you can use when you come across different types of scenarios where you want to find out what type of file it is, whether a sticky bit has been set or whether it's a pipe file. I mean, you would have heard about named pipes where you create a file through which communication happens. So all these things you can find out using this file test operators. Now, one of the things that we should also note with this kind of file test operators is that if you look at this code, so previously we got an error about usage. So if you, the most important part in any shell script is to tell the user how to use this. So if you look at this first part, one of the bugs that I had mentioned is that if I give more than one file name, what happens to this code, okay? And probably it will throw out an error. So let's try to find out whether such a thing happens. So if you, for example, if I gave file test.sh, then I give some two files, let's say file test.sh, so file test.sh and as well as new files.sh. Now you see what happens is it doesn't test the second program. I mean, if you test only the first program, it doesn't test the second program. So your script, okay, whatever you write, as I told you, when you do unit test, you will also identify these type of errors. So in this case, what happens is that you have to repeat this again and again to find out what type of files and all that. So the question is, does shell provide a mechanism by which I can repeatedly execute the same command on different test set of files? Yes, you would have heard about exarchs in the previous sections, okay, when you were taught about Unix commands, but the functionality of exarchs can also be brought by using shell script, and we will see in the next section how we can get this using the for statement, okay. And so in the case of for statement, what we could do is that we can repeatedly execute the current program with every file, and let us see in the next section how to go about doing it. Thank you.